Sunday after Pentecost. Now, I don't want to get into competitions. However, you notice there were four women and three men in the choir. Gotta make it equal, guys. Need more men in the choir, gotta even it up. And maybe even, you know, I mean, if we had a vote, it'd be 4-3. So we need to equal it up a little bit. So men, come on. I know you can sing. I heard you on Father's Day. Now, having said that, don't forget that this week, of course, is Benevolence Week. Benevolence is a separate offering to help members who may be in financial need. If you'd like to donate, please place the offering in the offering box with the cross on it in the back of the church. Also, don't forget the raffles coming up this Thursday when we have our Bible class. Right after that, they will have the raffle for all those wonderful prizes that you saw. So get your tickets turned in before Thursday. Women's Ceaseless Praise will be singing the prayer on Saturday, July 22nd and Sunday, August 13th. One more practice left, which will be July 19th. If you're interested, please see Carol. And we are in need of greeters and community helpers. If you could help us out with that, please sign up on the list of the narthex. And now that the week is back to normal, Tuesday morning, of course, we have our Bible class with the men for Sisters Restaurant at 8 a.m. Thursday morning, as I had mentioned, we have a Bible class in the Fellowship Hall at 9 a.m. We're looking at St. John's First Epistle, raffle to follow this week. And of course, right after worship this morning, we'll be taking another look at the great gospel events in the lives of Elijah and Elisha. And we'll be looking at Elijah and Elisha's call this morning. So if you're interested in that, hang around after church. That takes care of my announcements. If anybody has one I'm unaware of, I think we need to welcome Tanya back. Have you got a cast or a boot?
Boot.
Boot, yeah. I can't hold you. Every time I thought to call you to see what your ankle was doing, I thought, you're not going to be home, you're running around on a broken ankle. But I'm glad to see you rubbing moving around. So, well, that takes care of all the announcements. So, please rise. We follow our order of service as printed in the service folder. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask him to forgive us. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us, and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Oh,
of God, the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Praise to our God. lesson is from the book of Zechariah, chapter 9, verses 9 through 12. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners from the waterless pit. Return to your fortress, O prisoners of hope. Even now, I announce that I will restore twice as much to you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read responsibly Psalm 145. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise.
His greatness no one can fathom.
One generation will commend your works to another.
They will tell of your mighty acts.
The Lord upholds all those who fall.
And lifts up all who are bowed down.
The eyes of all look to you, and you will give them their food at the proper time.
You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing.
The Lord is near to all who call on him.
To all who call on him in truth.
He fulfills the desires of those who fear him.
He hears their cry and saves them.
The second lesson is from the book of Romans, chapter 7, verses 15 through 25. I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but the sin living in me. I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For what I do is not the good I want to do, no, the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is the sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind, and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. What a wretched man I am! Who will rescue me from his body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I myself in mind am a slave to God's law, but in the sinful nature a slave to the law of sin. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
11th chapter.
Glory to you, O God.
At that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this was your good pleasure. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and to those whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Atomic bomb drills? What do you think? The world is going crazy. And we worry about it not so much for ourselves, but for our children and our grandchildren. And so weary and burdened. Are you weary and burdened? Jesus might be onto something. When I think about being weary and burdened, I mean, it isn't bad enough that I've just gone went through all the things that are happening in the world, right? I'm sitting here telling you all the things that are happening out there, and yet we still got to be weary and burdened about all the things that are happening in our home, in our relationships, at work or at school. So many things that are going on in our lives, we can feel exhausted, tired, just plain weary, especially if you're dealing with health issues. Both short-term and long-term, doesn't matter. Lab work, CAT scans, MRIs, radiation and chemotherapy, appointments where you're poked and prodded like a lab rat. You go to your doctor, you have that lingering condition where the doctor just doesn't have any answers for you. He doesn't tell you how or why. And he especially doesn't tell you how it can go away. Weary and burdened. Don't think about what's going on out there. Consider what's happening in your spiritual life. You heard St. Paul in the second lesson, right? St. Paul talks about that interior or that constant battle the sinful nature has with the new creation, where he knows the good he wants to do, he cannot do. It's the evil he doesn't want to do that he keeps on doing. Can't you get weary and burdened from having to deal with that? And so now after having me list all these things, all the pains and woes that people are dealing with, after hearing about all the things that we have to deal with and worry about in the world, did you come to the same conclusion that I did? I'll tell you if you didn't. What amazes me the most, what amazes me when I think about everything that's going out in the world and everything that's happening in my own life, it's obvious. We don't have any answers. We don't have any answers. So I'm going to ask you again. Are you weary and burdened? You know, Jesus' message for the weary and burdened people in this world is a very beautiful and confident portion of Scripture. Jesus says, come to me. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. There is the answer. Jesus gives us the rest that we need. You know, this Bible passage, especially verse 28, is really a standby. It's kind of a go-to for pastors. Anytime we have to run to the hospital for an emergency call, or maybe it's to a shut-in visit, or maybe it's just counseling someone in the office, it doesn't matter. It's this section of the gospel that we have before us today that I use all the time because it really hosts all kinds of moments in a person's daily life, in the life of a Christian, in the life of a person that belongs to God. It's a joy to shine those beloved words of Jesus into many dark corners of our human experience. But for us to better understand the rest that Jesus is talking about, to better understand the rest that Jesus gives to weary and burdened people, we got to go back a little bit. As a matter of fact, we have to look at the gospel before our reading for this morning. So I'm going to give you a lesson. I'm assuming all of you know the Gospel of Matthew inside and out. Right? You all know Matthew's Gospel. Very for Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, right? So you began with Matthew. You know it like the back of your hand. But I'm going to give you a little lesson. You know how in chapters 1 and 2, that's how Jesus' life begins. Begins with his genealogy. And then, of course, we have the Christmas story. You have Gabriel and Mary and Joseph and Herod. You have the wise men. And then all of a sudden, there's a 30-year gap. And then in chapters 3 and 4, that's when Jesus begins his ministry. You see Jesus preaching and teaching and healing, and the crowds are flocking to him. I mean, he's got people lined up on the lake shores, lined up on the mountainsides. There's hardly a whisper of any opposition to Jesus' ministry for the first year he's doing it. Raise your hand if you order from Amazon. Only reason I say that is because you'd understand what I'm about to say. Because where there was no opposition to Jesus' ministry that first year, everybody would have gave him a 4.9 star rating. You only know what that means if you order from Amazon. Then we get to chapter 10, as we've been reading for the last couple of weeks for the gospel lessons, and Jesus sends out 12 of his disciples into the kingdom of God. He tells them to go out and preach. Go preach the message, the kingdom of God is here. But as he sends them out, he says something a little strange. Jesus says to his disciples as he's sending them out, all men will hate you because of me. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Remember that from last week? Now, if you didn't already know the whole story of Jesus' life, if you were just one of his excited disciples back in 27 AD, maybe a question would have came to mind. I know it did for me. If I was one of those disciples and Jesus said, all men will hate you because of me, I didn't come to bring peace but a sword, I would have started thinking, Jesus, what are you talking about? Look around you. Look at all the people that have come to you. Look at the crowds that are following you. Everybody loves you. You must have been staying up too late praying last night. And then we get to where we're at. And the chapter right before our reading, Jesus explains a few things. And then we get to where we're at today. Did you notice how the gospel started this morning? Say yes, just kidding. Jesus says, at that time, Jesus said. Now, didn't you wonder? I mean, for me, I was reading this and I went, well, what is it? What happened at that time, right? What happened at that time to make Jesus say what he's about to say? I mean, sure, the crowds have been following him everywhere. They were all gathering around him, but they weren't listening to the message he brought. They weren't repenting. And so in the moments before our gospel lesson for today, Matthew says, then Jesus began to denounce the cities in which most of his miracles had been performed because they did not repent. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. If the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be lifted up to the skies? No, you will go down to the depths. If the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Sodom, it would have remained to this day. But I tell you that it will be more bearable for Sodom on the day of judgment than for you. You see, the problem was the people were coming to Jesus, but they weren't repenting. They weren't listening. I mean, there was no change of heart in them after seeing the miracles or hearing the gospel message. And those miracles proved that Jesus was who he said he was. He is the Son of God. But people were coming for the show, and they were bringing grandma to be healed, but they weren't there repenting. They weren't listening to the message. They didn't have time for that repentance stuff. No time for that. So Jesus denounced them. Now, this is where being a pastor gets to be fun. Because when you're reading this, you can see Jesus is doing exactly what I would do. And it can happen, just like Jesus said, woe to you, Bethsaida, woe to you, Capernaum, woe to you, Chorazin. Pastors can do the same thing. Pastors love to stand up here at the pulpit and say, woe to you, you sinners! All of you! Sinners! Preacher can do that. Got one back here. I wish you would sit there so you could see it. We can do that really easy, isn't it? Easy to preach the law, because you're all bad. But with the very next words, the words of our lesson, Jesus proves that he's more than a pastor. As a matter of fact, he maintains that balance of law and gospel that every pastor aspires to. Immediately after denouncing those people for not repenting, Jesus says, at that time. At that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Entire towns had rejected Jesus and gave him shallow praise. Jesus could see their hearts. He knew what was going on in their hearts. But he also could see the hearts of his humble followers who were not the wise and learned. They weren't the people who were rich. They weren't the people who were educated. The people that Jesus was thinking about were the people who prayed before every meal. The people that Jesus was praying about were the ones who came to God for forgiveness. The ones who knew that they needed Jesus. And Jesus looks at those humble people and he prays God for each and every one of them. You see, when Jesus looks at us, He just beams with joy. Father, I praise you because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to the little children. Now, doesn't that give you rest? Doesn't it? Knowing that God thinks of you each and every day, that Jesus is praying for you each and every day. It is in his joy that Jesus gives us another something that we can see as rest, something that every Lutheran knows but needs to be reminded about from time to time. You see, when you look at the reason that there were real followers following after Jesus, the reason that Jesus had his disciples, that they were there beside him, is because God had revealed his salvation to them. It didn't matter how smart they were. It didn't matter how choices they made or what effort they made to please God. And that's a good thing. Because if you had to depend on yourself, if you had to depend on how smart you are, or how the right choices you would make, or the effort that you would put into pleasing God to get into heaven, you would never really be sure that you were smart enough, that you had believed enough, or that you were sorry enough. You wouldn't be driven back to God's promises, but would always be driven to where you had to rely on what you do, which is tainted with sin even on your best day. Jesus assures us that faith is a gift revealed by God and placed into an unbeliever's heart. Even little children. That's why he can say, little children who aren't able to understand what's going on yet, but yet they too can be saved. Because it doesn't depend on anything we do. It doesn't depend on any choice we make. It depends on God's grace. And if it's all about grace, then even little children can believe. Now, I know it's hard for some people to get their heads wrapped around that because sometimes we intellectualize our faith too much. But here and elsewhere in Scripture, Jesus says that even little children can believe. And so we boldly invite parents to believe their children to the baptism, or to bring their children to the baptismal font, so the Holy Spirit can create that faith. We tell parents to have devotions with your children at home because it's working through the Holy Spirit's working through the Word of God so that even little children can believe. It's about God's work. It's not about choice. And in expressing his joy over his people, Jesus then says this, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Is that simple? Jesus invites everyone to know him and to find rest. He's truly the good shepherd. Shepherd cares about or is concerned about their sheep. Everybody here that has children, right? You all worried about your kids. You were hoping that they would grow up and have all the experiences in life that helped them grow, but you don't want them to have the experiences that take the joy out of life. Every parent wants what's best for their children, better than they have. And it's the same way that Jesus desires to give peace to every person in the entire world. That's why he died for every person in the entire world. He paid for our sins so that we can live with him eternally. And more than that, he sacrificed himself so that each and every step of our lives, we can have the guarantee of eternal rest in heaven. And so day by day, that's what you and I cling to. We cling to the rest that Jesus gives. He gives us rest from being worried and burdened about the craziness and all the chaos that's going on in the world. And he helps us realize that he has placed you right where he wants you to be. Have you ever thought about that? You know how people always say, what's our purpose in life and why are we here? Look at where you're at right now. What you're doing, doesn't matter if you're a teacher, a plumber, Indian, it doesn't matter. You're at right where you are, where Jesus has called you. And don't forget that every single person you have in your life, Jesus has placed there in your life to be there, right where they're at. And he's done that for one reason. Whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. And so we find rest in living God's glory, living out God's glory, and helping our neighbor. Do you ever think about that much? The world is always there. The world is always trying to influence. Now be honest with me. Which one of you out there, raise your hand, who's constantly on Facebook or Instagram or Snapchat or any of those little apps that all the kids are using? Come on, be honest. Right, put it up there. Come on, Tanya. I know you're on Facebook. The church has a Facebook page. But think about it. Look at the expectation the world has. The world is trying to tell everybody how beautiful they need to be and how successful they're going to be and how intelligent they need to be. But Jesus says you don't need any of that. He accepts us just as we are because we're clothed in his righteousness. He gives us rest from those deep sorrows that we have, sorrows of the heart, the ones that keep us up at night, the ones filled with loss and hurt. But he reminds us that all those stubborn sorrows that take a long time to go away, one day will be swallowed up in the joys of heaven. He gives us rest from the regrets of the past. He reminds us that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. So even our regrets, God will use for his purpose. He will use it to work the glory of what he does in our lives. He gives us rest from a guilty conscience and the sins we commit. And he daily reminds you that I will forgive your wickedness and remember your sins no more. I'm going to ask you again, one more time. Are you weary and burdened? If you are, Jesus gives you the rest that you need. It's that simple. No matter how crazy things get in our lives, out in the world, even in the church, Jesus gives us the rest because of everything he's done to save us. So raise your hand if you're weary or burdened. Yeah, we got a few. Jesus gives you the rest you need. Brothers and sisters, this is God's word for you this morning. Please rise. And now may the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now join together in confessing our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, you ensure that the birds are fed and the lilies clothed in splendor. Deliver us from worry with the consolation that you know what we need and that, for Jesus' sake, we are of much more value than they. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Kindle in us, Holy Father, the gifts of your Spirit, that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Heavenly Father, fill our homes with your word and grace. Be the companion of those who are alone. Strengthen husbands and wives. Bless parents as they catechize their children. Let them all find refuge in you and so preserve them from every plague and evil. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Ruler of the nations, until you at last cut off the war horse and the chariot forever, give our nation's leaders wisdom and integrity to preserve peace, promote what is good, and defend against violence and wickedness. Bless our president, our governor, our state and local leaders, all who make, judge, and administer our laws. Bless our brothers and sisters in the military, law enforcement, and our first responders. Lord, in your mercy, Lord God, be with all who are weary and heavy laden with the tribulations of this life. Give comfort to all who are listed on our prayer list and whose names we carry in our hearts. all who are suffering from illness, and all recovering from accidents and surgery. Console them with the knowledge that your yoke is easy and your burden light, and that in you they will find rest for their souls. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God of Israel, you release your people from the waterless pit by the blood of your covenant. Bless all who receive Christ's body and blood with penitent hearts, trusting in your promises and a common confession of faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks to you, Lord. We give thanks to you, O Lord, for all the saints who by your grace sought your kingdom and righteousness above all other treasures. We pray that you would preserve us also in repentance and Christ's righteousness until we stand before you in glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of your one and only Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who also taught us to pray,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, share the Lord's peace. Always give our gifts with sincerity and generosity, moved by your love for us,
and our love for you.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is good and right so to do.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. He sends the Holy Spirit to testify that we are his children and to strengthen us when we are weak. Now have come the salvation, the power, and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. O God in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He then took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." O Christ, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world, have mercy on us and grant us your peace.
Amen.
Please be seated. Please rise.
Amen.